Welcome to Channel 17, the Town of Colonie Government Channel.
Hello, and welcome to Getting to Know You. I'm your host, Robert Jaquay. I'm really excited about our guest today. He's new to our area, and so we're really going to get to know him. His name is Brad Shear, and he's the executive director of the Mohawk and Hudson River Humane Society. Let's go meet Brad. Brad, I want to thank you very much for agreeing to be a guest here today.
Thank you for having me.
Now, before we start talking about the organization, I'd like our viewers to know a little bit about you and you know, where you came from and how you came to the Mohawk and Hudson River Humane Society.
Well, I was born and raised in Manhattan, in New York City. In 1988, I moved to Boulder, Colorado, and eventually started working for the Humane Society of Boulder Valley. Started out working in the kennels, working at the front desk. I had a background in restaurant management. And the society at the time was looking for people who could improve their customer service. And they were great animal caregivers, but not the best people care givers, which can be typical in animal shelters. So we were working to sort of bring that to the next level. And we eventually, I started working at the front desk and ran the animal control department for the city of Boulder. I then was the shelter manager for the Humane Society in Boulder and soon moved back to Brooklyn, where I was the manager for the Brooklyn shelter of the Center for Animal Care and Control, which is New York City's animal shelter system.
Okay.
In Boulder, we were a shelter that saw about 6,500 animals a year. In Brooklyn, we took in about 30,000 animals a year. So the difference between a relatively small western town
That's
with
huge.
A population of 100,000 people, and then you move to New York City, and there's a big difference in everything, in capacity and culture. I moved back to Boulder and again ran the city animal control department. So we did cruelty investigations. I was involved in disaster response for animals, which became important during Hurricane Katrina.
Right.
And did that for several years. Then moved to Atlanta, where I was the director of operations for the Atlanta Humane Society. Again, a big change because that animal shelter, while large, also had a very large public veterinary clinic. So our veterinary clinic saw about 9,500 low-income clients a year, and all really wellness care, people whose animals wouldn't have been spayed or neutered without the Humane Society, would not have been vaccinated or ever seen a veterinarian without the Humane Society. Many of these animals were geriatric before coming to us for the first time. And just a couple months ago, I came to the Capital District, and now I'm the executive director of the Mohawk and Hudson River Humane Society.
And welcome.
Thank you.
And I guess just in the nick of time, you were brought into a situation that was problematic. Mm-hmm. And in a article in the TU recently, it's like you've taken the bull by the horns and in a short period of time, mm-hmm. to help to turn that around. And I would imagine the image of a humane society or an animal shelter, mm-hmm. is very important in how it's perceived by the public. Even if they don't have animals, people have feelings.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Any nonprofit organization, any organization like ours that's serving the community, needs the support of the community, and how we're perceived makes a tremendous difference for how well we can operate. And the society has seen some difficult years, but I think that's changing, and it's by no means me alone. There are some very effective people on our board of directors. We have some fantastic staff and volunteers, and I think what I've been able to do is bring in a perspective from outside, let people know what's going on the national level, what new programs and new focuses there are at other animal shelters throughout the country. And when people see how these sort of newer systems work, they're really embracing them. And I think I've been able to help people just work together a little better and in the future, we'll achieve a lot more. We have a ways to go, mm-hmm. but things are improving pretty rapidly.
You're going to be a real trailblazer, and bringing people together for this mm-hmm. this common, you know, mm-hmm. goal and the vision is really great. How about the history of this organization? Mm-hmm. How long has it been around? Mm-hmm. And I mean, I've been in this area for about 30 years, and mm-hmm. I you know, it's been here for 30 years at least, but I'm sure it predates me.
We were originally founded in 1887 as the Albany Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children. And it was a couple years later, 1889, that we were incorporated then as the Mohawk and Hudson River Humane Society, still at the time with a focus on child welfare. It wasn't until 1893 that the Albany chapter of the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals merged with the Humane Society and was actually the first organization in New York State that had the mission of protecting both children and animals. And the reason that there were a lot of organizations at the time that protected both children and animals because both were considered property and the laws that protected them were actually very similar.
Interesting.
So it made sense for just as the ASPCA in New York City, was the first organization to help prosecute child abuse. We, again, follow that same model and protecting both children and animals. One of our founders, Dr. William Stillman, is really one of the great citizens in the history of the Capital District. He became president of the society, and the society grew tremendously under his leadership. In the early 1900s, we actually oversaw humane societies in 12 counties in the Capital District. We had two orphanages, one for boys and one for girls.
I think this is so interesting.
and the Menands shelter, which is still standing today, was built in 1913. And actually that 1913 building is still standing. it was originally a farm. Both dogs and livestock were brought there and protected there. And it was actually up all the way up until 1957 that we still had orphanages. And we also had the animal control officers worked for the society. The probation officers that oversaw children worked for the society, and the society's goal for children was to keep them out of the prisons. If the society and the state felt that the kids were rehabilitatable, they would go to the society's orphanages. And as the state and other groups started protecting children more, the need for the society to care for both animals and children started to wane, and we started focusing mostly on animals in the late 50s.
Okay.
And since then, we've been continuing to grow. In 1957, we built what was at the time only the second veterinary clinic run by a nonprofit organization in New York State. And we're continuing to operate that clinic by spaying and neutering all of our own animals and caring for the animals in the shelter. So it's really a tremendous history. William Stillman was involved in some of the earliest animal protection laws in New York State and was also a national leader. He was the president of the American Humane Association. At the same time, he was the president of the Humane Society here. So he was nationally known as one of the founders of the humane movement, and it's from right here in the town of Bethlehem.
Wow. This is who would have known? Imagine that. Now, as an organization, the word animal shelter. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're a lot more than an animal shelter.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, let's hear about the actual what goes on there.
Well, of course, as you said, we are an animal shelter. So we're taking in stray, orphaned, abandoned animals every day. Are coming to the society. They're being seen by veterinarians. Being treated for illnesses and injuries, being spayed or neutered, and being adopted. In addition to that, we are the SPCA for both Albany and Rensselaer counties.
Okay.
So, but as the SPCA, we are charged with investigating cruelty under Article 7 of the state agriculture and markets law. And so we support towns and cities and their dog control officers or animal control officers when they're investigating cruelty. Our cruelty investigator will go with them, help them make a case that can then be brought to the district attorneys.
Okay.
And that, in that role, not only are we protecting small animals, the dogs and cats and rabbits that we commonly see at the shelter, a lot of the investigation, one of the things that surprised me coming from Colorado and Georgia, it really surprised me coming back to upstate New York, how many of our cases involve large animals, horses, cattle, hogs, all of these animals that are present in New York State, and in my mind, coming from New York City, and my perspective on the state,
you wouldn't normally see.
I didn't imagine that coming here we would see so much of a need to investigate neglect and cruelty of those larger animals, but there's a tremendous need, and luckily we have several people on staff and several people who work with us who have some excellent expertise in those areas, but there's a real need for it.
Now, I can't imagine someone brings a horse or a pig to the to the shelter, so this is really in this purpose. But do people, do you only take in dogs? You mentioned rabbits, so do you take in other animals?
We get dogs, cats, rabbits, pet rodents of all kinds. We have a couple ferrets right now.
I was going to say ferrets.
We had, not long ago, had an iguana, and we get other kinds of reptiles. We get birds, you name it, and it has come in. And there have been in the past horses on the property. We have 17 acres.
Okay.
We don't have great facilities for livestock, so we have some other people in the community that will take them in, but in a pinch, we've had to have them there before.
What will normally bring an animal to the shelter?
Typically, about half of our animals are coming in as strays, just coming in off the street, either picked up by dog control officers or private citizens. And some of them are genuinely lost animals, and their owners might come and pick them up. Some of them are animals that have just been living on the street, might have been born on the street, and they're coming in, and it's maybe the first time they've been indoors for some of them. And then the other half are being brought in by private citizens who either are moving somewhere and they, for a variety of reasons, can't bring the animals with them, or they're having behavior difficulties with them, they're having medical difficulties and they can't or decide not to treat those illnesses. So there's sort of a wide variety.
Now, do you ever walk in the morning and someone has sort of, during the night, dropped an animal off or you know, left a cage or anything like that, or is that not typical?
Occasionally we do get that. It's not that common. I think we're open 7 days a week, so it's pretty convenient for people. The animal control officers in the area, we have about 12 towns that we contract with to be their animal shelter. They have access to the building to bring animals in, so there is signage there. If somebody shows up in the middle of the night, they can call the town, and the town will bring them inside instead of letting them sit out all night.
So a lot of the animals come to you through the animal control people in the towns and villages around here, as well as individuals. And I would imagine that people would call their local. For instance, in Colonie, I would call my animal control person probably first. And then they would guide it, or they will take the animal for you rather than say, why don't you take it down?
Right. If you find a stray dog, then you could call the town of Colonie or whatever town you live in, and they would pick it up for you. Although if you bring it directly to us, we would take it that way as well. Yeah. It's usually a good idea to contact the town anyway if you found a stray, even if you bring it directly to us, because people will call the town to ask the officers if they've found their pet. And it's just good to cover all those bases so that if someone's lost their pet, then as many people as possible know that where it was found and where it is now.
One of the things I'm scooting around a little bit, but one of the things I saw on the webpage in terms of services is microchipping. Now, do you actually do microchipping there, or do you advocate for microchipping, or?
Well, both. We do it and we advocate for it. Every animal that's every dog and cat that's adopted from us has a microchip. They're all included in the adoption price. They're registered with a national database. We scan every animal that comes in, and if people want to come in and get their animal microchipped, we will do that for a very reasonable fee. We feel it's one of those things that's so very important. It's permanent identification. It still does not replace the good old collar and tag.
Right.
Because 95% of the time, the first person who finds your dog is not going to have a scanner, but they're going to have a phone. And if you got your phone number on that tag, you avoid a lot of heartache and a lot of difficulty in trying to figure out where your pet is. Right. And the other issue with the microchips is if you've got a microchip in your pet, every time you move or a phone number changes, you have to call. and change that information. And we have a dog right now, actually, that has a microchip, and the phone numbers we have are disconnected because the person moved and didn't update that information.
Yeah.
So it's a good system, and we know that the dog has an owner, and we're seeking that person out. We have a name, but it's not a perfect system. The tag is a good old tag.
Yep.
Is a great thing to have.
That's important to stress. And I am an advocate of microchipping, and our dog got out a year or so ago, and it was because of the microchipping that she could be positively identified. And so it's a small cost in the long run for
Absolutely.
Something like that. Now, animals, you mentioned strays, but do people bring an animal? They bring an animal because there are behavioral problems. Things
More
are going wrong at home
right.
with yep. the animal for a variety of reasons.
Right, and both cats and dogs, we see that with. I think cats, it's very frequently litter box problems. People get a cat and they assume they're 100%
It's litter box trained. Right?
It's instinctive, and it really is, most of the time, very instinctive. And sometimes those problems with not using the litter box are medical problems. Sometimes they're behavioral. Both times they can be worked with. The more and more with dogs, we're seeing them because of behavior issues. People are getting dogs at a young age, and they're not working with them with a trainer at that early age to really get them to be well-behaved in their home and become a part of the family. And they're treated more like children and babied a little bit, and they really need some structure and some training. Dogs love structure, and they love to work and to be trained. So one of the things that we are working on now is we have several staff who are very knowledgeable about animal training, and when someone brings us an animal that is having a behavior problem and they're giving them up and maybe they felt like they worked with them as much as they can, our staff will counsel them about the problem. Say they're chewing up and destroying things when you're not home. Well, our staff will talk to those people, give them some tools, give them ideas on how to work with them, maybe give them a referral to a dog trainer, and get that animal back into its home. We continue following up with those people to see how things are going, continue giving them advice and working with them, and those animals can stay in their home instead of coming to the shelter and having to use the resources of the shelter to find the animal a new home.
Do you sense that most people who are in this situation really don't know what to do and would like to know what to do? Or, it's a psychological thing when people bring them in, obviously. You say, maybe we can do something with your dog, but are people just distraught? They just don't know what to do next?
A lot of people are. If you come to the Humane Society on a lot of days and you see people surrendering the animals that are really a part of their family, they are crying. They are miserable. They do not want to give up this pet, but they're at wit's end,
okay. And
they just don't know what to do. So we are trying to give them that resource now so they don't have to lose that family member. And when you see people who are that distraught about having to come and give up their pet, you know that there's an opportunity there to try to keep the animal in the home if they're willing to do a little bit of work and just change the way that they're working with the animal a little bit. There are all these TV shows now we see about.
Yes, fortunately, yeah.
Everybody from Oprah on on down is trying to work with their animal's behavior and keep them in the home, make them more a part of the family. And we're having some success.
Great.
And
so it's good to know.
Yeah.
Good to know,
absolutely.
And I'm glad we could talk about that. I think one of the saddest things is when people, are moving or leaving and for that reason, they seem to feel that they have to leave their animal behind, or people get married and the spouse to be doesn't like cats or something like that. That's that to me is a hard one.
Yeah,
I'd probably give up the spouse. Anyway, that's me.
Well, I might have to agree with you.
So really, education is a part of the mission you have going on down there. What other things in that line?
Well, education is extremely important for us, and we need to start. And historically, we have not done this, but we need to really start getting into the schools and talking to children at a young age because they are the future pet owners for our community, and we need to let them know that about appropriate ways to handle pets educate them about spay and neuter, make those services available. So we are talking about things like spaying and neutering pets and overpopulation, how to identify animals, like you mentioned, with microchipping, and cruelty prevention, which is extremely important. We've had a couple of issues in the last couple of weeks of some very serious acts of cruelty in the region. And one of the things that I've worked on personally in for many years in my career is educating people about the connection between animal cruelty and domestic violence and other kinds of violence. And the people who are committing these kinds of crimes are not just hurting animals. If maybe you care about the animals, maybe you don't. No, I think that you should. But if you don't, just think about that person and their temper, how aggressive they became to hurt whatever was the most convenient, defenseless, living thing around. And the next one could be a child, the next one could be a spouse, the next one could be the girlfriend or the
right,
or whoever is nearby. And these people are very dangerous, and that an understanding of that connection is so important to us as the SPCA, and I think important to the community so that they can feel safe.
You know, as much as we recoil when we hear these things, and you know, depending on how we are attached, but I think everybody does. Mm-hmm. I think it's wonderful that we're hearing about these things on the news, you know, and they're really making it known, you know, what can go on and how horrible it can be.
Right.
So,
well, and not just hearing about it, but also we have police departments in Troy and the city of Albany that went and arrested these people.
Yep.
We had citizens in both communities that called. We have prosecutors in both counties and the district attorney's office who are aggressively pursuing these people. All of that needs to happen. You have to have the people who make the phone call. You have to have the police who are concerned and understand it's important and show up. And you have to have prosecutors and ultimately judges and juries who understand the importance of the issue. And if you don't have all that, you can write all the laws you want.
Right.
But if the infrastructure isn't there and the community concern isn't there, nothing ever happens.
And clearly seeing the consequences is very important.
Absolutely.
Now, you know, we think of beating as an animal cruelty, but there's other ways that you can define that.
Absolutely. The most common ones that we see on television are the beating cases, like the ones that we've seen recently. We're also seeing dog fighting. In our communities, we think that there is a rise in dog fighting. We know of some just street fighting that's happening in Troy, where people show up at a certain location at a designated time and fight a couple dogs and get away. But it's not just in that city, but in others. And there's also neglect, people who are not providing veterinary care, they're not providing appropriate food or water for the animals. And we have at least one case that we know of hoarding, more commonly known as collecting, where people will collect huge numbers of animals, will collect enormous numbers of anything. They don't throw anything out. You'll go into these houses and you'll see 30 or 40 years of newspapers and trash and everything else that has never gone out of their house and just come in. And often, most frequently, what I've seen is cats, but you can have dogs, you can have livestock, you can have, we had one case where there was a monkey on the property. I worked on a case in Colorado where there were 80 birds in the house, just loose in terrible condition, and the house, we had to wear hazmat suits to walk in the house because of respiratory issues that we would have suffered. And you can imagine the animals living in those conditions 24 hours, 7 days a week, they have very similar respiratory systems to us. And I can't walk in there for an hour without a respirator. It's very difficult for them. So all of these cases come up in the Capital District, and we need, the way that we find out about them usually is a neighbor.
Yep.
We found out about one in that I worked on in Colorado where the person was having their groceries delivered, and the grocery delivery boy, when the door opened and the smell hit him, said, "There's something wrong here." And that triggered our investigation. And you know, we can go from there. Often these people this is a mental illness these people have.
Yeah,
they need to be cared for. Often seniors, often single women, and they usually need help. And hopefully cases where we can work with human service agencies to get these people help, but at the same time make sure that they're not going to have animals again.
And so what you do in that case, you amass a whole bunch of sick animals.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And malnourished and all that kind of thing.
Yeah, and when they're in those sorts of confined spaces, there's usually one of them will be ill and disease will spread throughout them, and you have all sorts of illnesses and physical issues with those animals in those homes.
I just was also thinking about, I mean, you know, you hear the term puppy mills. Is that still very much a dynamic that people are breeding animals and inbreeding and all that kind of stuff just to profit from them, right?
Absolutely. A very big issue. There's a bill in the legislature right now that would change the law to regulate puppy mills in New York State. What's happening with puppy mills, Kansas used to be known as the puppy mill state. Pennsylvania has quite a few.
Okay.
They're coming now into New York as other states are tightening up their laws around the care of these animals. These groups are looking for states where they're not as regulated. Well, New York State does not have great regulation around puppy mill laws. They regulate anyone who sells an animal directly to a person, a retailer, but there's not regulation of wholesalers. So if I'm breeding a dog and I'm selling it to a pet store, I'm not being regulated. There is a bill in the legislature right now that would change that law so there would be more oversight of puppy mills or wholesalers, and we're working on gathering support for that.
Now, I know because of what you do, I mean, we're a really strong advocate for people adopting a pet.
Correct.
If someone does choose to go to a pet store, how would they possibly know where their animal's coming from?
I would avoid, if you want a certain kind of pet, I imagine the reason that you're going to a pet store is you want maybe a specific breed and you want a puppy. And maybe you've tried, first try a breed rescue group. There are many groups all over New York State and all over New England that work on rescuing specific
particular breeds.
So I would start with them, and we can help you find them. If you call the Humane Society, we're happy to help you find other groups that work with those animals. And maybe it'll take a little longer to find exactly what you want than walking into the pet store and just buying that dog, but you're going to work with a group that has worked with a veterinarian to make sure the animal is healthy and that is going to try to make a good match between you and that pet. When you walk in a pet store, you have no way of knowing where that animal came from, and there's no question that if this pet store has, say, 10 different breeds of puppies all year round, they've always got them, those are coming from puppy mills.
Mm-hmm.
They're not getting them from local breeders. Good breeders, and there are good breeders that breed maybe one litter a year. They're working in with, say, AKC trials. They're neutering animals that are not improving the breed. There are some out there. Then they are not selling to pet stores. The pet stores are getting their animals from these huge puppy mills and I've seen these dogs after they've been used for breeding, and they'll use animals over and over for years and years. They live their entire lives in a cage, and you get some of them out of these puppy mills, and I've seen them where they just stand still. You have to push them to get them to walk because they've never walked anywhere before. They just lived in a cage and bred and bred and bred.
Wow.
And one litter after another, and they're just breeding whatever female is in heat to whatever male is available, so you get brother and sister, and the papers don't really mean anything because there's really no regulation of the papers that you get. I can give you papers if you whatever papers you want.
Put them right on the internet, right?
But they're really anyone can start a breed. Anybody can start a registry and make some nice letterhead.
Right.
And you're seeing all kinds of different registries. You've seen the AKC for many years, but others now are around that will register almost any dog.
Okay. But AKC is still a pretty safe bet. I mean, there's a way to...
AKC does not regulate breeders.
Okay.
They do not do anything to ensure the quality of that animal. The AKC is just trying, I don't know how successful they are, what they're trying to say is this dog was born from these two dogs.
This lineage.
That's all they're saying is this is the lineage of the dog. But if you call them and say, you know, I got a dog from this breeder and the dog was unhealthy, they don't regulate that.
Okay.
They're just tracking the lineage of the dog.
Good. Good information. I mean, yeah, absolutely. Now, people come to you and say, I want to adopt a cat. I want to adopt a dog. What do they do?
Well, they come in, and we're open 7 days a week. They're welcome to take a look at all cats we have available, either at our shelter in Menands, or we have 2 7-day-a-week adoption centers at PetSmart in Glenmont and East Greenbush.
Okay.
And if they see an animal they're interested in, they talk to one of our staff or volunteers who are trained to counsel people on adoption. We tell people what we know about the animal in the cats and dogs. We evaluate their temperament. We have a system that was developed by a PhD certified animal behaviorist, and that person then certified our staff to perform this test, so we get an idea of what this animal's like, primarily that it's an animal that's going to be safe, and then a little bit about personality. We talk to you about your lifestyle. What are you looking for? Are you very active? Are you more of a couch potato? Do you want an animal that's affectionate? Do you want an animal that is going to go running with you? Do you want one that just sits and watches TV on the couch with you all day? What exactly is it you're looking for? And then we try to guide you towards the best match for you.
So someone can say, I want that puppy. You got to really go through a process.
You go through a process, and the process isn't difficult. It's just, well, you know, have you had a puppy before? A lot of people maybe had a puppy when they were growing up, like I did when I was a kid, and had no idea what their parents did to raise that puppy. You were just the one who played with it. So we try to tell people as much as we can about proper care, about training, and try to set them up for success so that they're not coming back in a year and we're starting that process where we're counseling.
Will you refuse somebody if you feel that they're not a good match?
There are times when we'll refuse them, and we usually don't have to. We can usually guide them towards a more appropriate animal.
Okay.
Typically when we're refusing them is someone who we know has a history of problems with animals. If we see someone who we know, we have a computer database that has people with histories of cruelty, dog fighting, other issues, and those people will raise a red flag, and those people will absolutely be denied.
Okay. Now, and it doesn't come, it's not free, right? There is a cost involved.
Yep. And our adoption fees, depending on the animal, range anywhere from $25 up to $300.
Okay.
Based on the demand. So the average price is about $100, which includes the spay and neuter, distemper vaccination, if they're old enough, a rabies vaccination, and a microchip. So just those things, without the animal.
But that's a bargain.
If you went to a veterinarian, you're probably paying a $200, $250 bill, which really is reasonable in itself. But I think you're getting a very good deal at the shelter just with the spay and neuter by itself.
Now, one of the other services that you offer is cremation.
Correct.
I know that when my dog died, he went to the Humane Society and was cremated, and I trusted the fact that when I got the cremains, that was going to be my dog, and I was assured by them at all. But can people also go themselves or call you and say, I want to cremate my dog or cat?
People can bring their pet directly to us
to
cremate them, and we actually have 2 crematories. Like you said, you wanted the remains back from yours, so that actually goes in a separate, entirely separate crematory from the one where people who say, I just want it cremated as a group and don't want the remains back.
Right.
So we both, probably your veterinarian, brought them to us. So we pick up from several veterinarians in the area every week and then bring them back to the veterinarian where you may pick them up. But we'll take them directly from people too. A lot of people don't want to bring their animal directly to us. And if you have a relationship with your veterinarian, and you're probably best off continuing to work with them.
Now, is there a cost? There's a charge for that?
There is a charge for that, and it depends on the weight of the animal. So that.
Okay. Now, you don't provide veterinarian services. I mean, someone can't use you as a vet, but you have adjunct veterinarian there. I mean, on staff, you actually have a veterinarian, right?
We have a veterinarian on staff, and we have a couple other veterinarians who just come in on a per diem basis for us. Obviously, he doesn't work 7 days a week, but We do have a medical director who does most of our spay and neuter surgery and takes care of the health of the animals. And it's really a different sort of medicine that shelter veterinarians do than, say, your veterinarian is practicing, because they've got to focus on the herd health. They're looking at really the way that disease transmits through all these animals that are coming from all sorts of different sources. And, you know, your veterinarian has you to say, well, my dog ate this today, and this is what he did, and I think he might have gotten into something, and here's what he could have gotten into in my house because the cabinet under the sink was open, and I saw chew marks on the, chemicals, and they have some idea. The animals come into us, and they have nothing. The veterinarian's job's hard enough.
Okay, so that's really focused on the animals that come to you. So people really shouldn't use or think. But I imagine you might get a stray call here and there, and then you would refer them back to the veterinarian.
Right.
And I'm sure you have some sort of relationship with all the veterinarians in the area.
Yeah, we have different relationships with all the veterinarians, and we encourage people. A lot of the veterinarians in the area, after you adopt a pet, will do a health exam for you for half price because you adopted it. And we ask people in the first 10 days, take that animal to a veterinarian, establish that relationship early on, get to know the vet, and take your animal in for regular visits. Just like you and I, you catch something early, and you do some preventative medicine, which is what good veterinarians are focused on, and you avoid a lot of heartache down the road. All of our adopters also get 30 days of free health insurance for their pet.
Oh, yeah.
So if they do have an illness in that first 30 days, then they pay a small copay, but most of that cost is covered by the insurance, and they can choose if they want to continue that insurance.
Now, I noticed that, I mean, and we'll, this is time to talk about your webpage, because you can also go on your webpage. We'll put the address on the screen. You can go on your webpage and find out all sorts of things, like we've been talking about. You can also click on to view animals that are adoptable. Their names, even there's some names for them. And you can pick, if you only want to look at dogs or only want to look at cats. So there's a lot of good information there. But I see you also partner with a variety of organizations, and one of them, it appears as though you're really advocating the possibility of pet insurance.
Yeah, we think pet insurance is becoming more and more important. We are seeing veterinary medicine has changed tremendously. Because people have made pets more and more a part of their family, they expect more and more in terms of health care. We have a veterinary clinic in the area that is installing an MRI. So for that would have been unheard of 20 years ago in veterinary medicine, to install a piece of equipment that's that expensive that people are going to have to pay a lot of money to use. And now people will do absolutely anything for their pet, but it comes at a great expense.
Sure does.
You hate to think, when your pet is very ill or near the end of their lives possibly, that you have to make finances a big concern. And I think that I would be careful. There are a lot of different types of pet insurance out there. I'd be careful about which one you choose and look at the policy carefully and see what it covers and see what you're going to have to pay. But it makes those decisions a little bit easier to know that you're going to get that help with the financial part of it, and it may end up extending your animal's life. You still have to depend on your veterinarian and their input and their decision making to make sure you're doing the right thing. But I have it.
Yeah. Well, in some cases, last year I wish I had it myself. But it's certainly something to consider, and I think people might stay away from it because they think it's probably too costly. Or, and you look at the kind of money we put into our auto insurance and other kind of things like that. And as you say, the value of a pet in our society is extremely high.
With a lot of these insurance plans, you'll find that the annual cost is probably less than your annual visit to your vet. And
these days, yes, probably.
And most of them don't necessarily cover the annual visit. A lot of them are covering more serious illnesses. But just to give you some perspective, it's relatively inexpensive.
We haven't talked about one topic, and I was thinking whether or not to just let it go. But one of the, I guess, sad truths about having animals in a shelter is that you're space limited. Animals are also ill and have behavioral issues, and there is that point in time where you have to euthanize an animal. Yep. And I think, you know, I'm very sensitive to animals. I get choked up real fast. Mm-hmm. You know, the thought of that anyway, mm-hmm. You know, for my own personal pet is a difficult one. But, I mean, how can we understand that? I mean, one of the, you say some really nice things in the article on the webpage, and, you know, you don't turn animals away, mm-hmm. but there comes a time when you have to make this difficult decision.
Right.
And so can we just talk a little bit about that?
Sure. It is a very difficult decision, and there's no one who wants to avoid euthanasia of an animal more than the people who have to do it. Everyone who works at the animal shelter came there because they love animals. Yep. No one is becoming wealthy or being successful or being lauded in the community because they're doing this hard work every day. They're doing it because they have a love of animals. A lot of these animals are coming from situations where they had no medical care and they're very ill, and really the most humane thing we can do for them is to put them out of their pain and misery. Some of them are extremely dangerous, aggressive animals. Like, as I said, sometimes we have dogs that have been involved in dog fighting and have been trained and encouraged to be aggressive, and they're just unsafe for the community. And many of them are just, we just couldn't responsibly put back into the community.
Right.
And there are some animals still that we just don't have the space for. The facility that we're in is an older facility. It's not large enough to handle the number of animals that are coming in from a community this size. And unfortunately, rarely so far this year, but occasionally we just, because we take every animal that comes to us, an animal comes to our door and we say, there is no kennel for that animal.
Mm.
And if we start, as some shelters have, there have been quite a bit in the news in the last year about animals that just, or animal shelters that have disease run rampant through them, and they euthanize sometimes hundreds of animals in a short period of time. There was a shelter in Las Vegas that, according to news reports, euthanized 1,000 animals at once because they were trying to be a no-kill shelter, which to them meant just don't euthanize any animals.
Under any circumstances.
Under any circumstances. And so very ill animals were then spreading illness to healthy animals that could have had a chance if a difficult but important decision had been made about those sick animals sooner. And we do treat some illnesses that are, you know, not life-threatening and they're unlikely to spread to other animals and that we can treat in the facilities that we have. But when we have an animal that has a very dangerous and potentially fatal illness to the whole population, then the most responsible thing we can do is think about the many that we have to care for.
It is responsible, and it is a decision that's made with care, I know, and for a variety of reasons.
Right.
And lest we get too maudlin here, I'm going to change the subject. We'll go back to, you know, it's a good reason for you to adopt a pet from the shelter,
absolutely,
isn't it?
Yeah. Exactly.
If we could only have more people do
yes.
that. Now, what are your hours of operation? You've said 7 days a week.
Yep, 10 to 6 Monday through Friday, 10 to 5 on Saturday, and 1 to 4 on Sunday.
Okay, and as you said, if someone goes there off hours, there are messages that let you know mm-hmm. that you can call your local animal control mm-hmm. and take care of something that
right.
should be taken
right.
care of right away.
Mm-hmm. If you have a stray animal, an injured animal that you find on the street, the first call should be to animal control.
Okay.
Because they can, especially if the animal's injured, they can take that animal directly to the emergency clinic and try to get a treatment.
Okay. And we do have this emergency clinic in the capital
yeah.
region,
yeah.
Which is, I guess, definitely a lifesaver and a great alternative.
Yeah.
I know
yeah,
I've been there.
Really true state-of-the-art
yeah.
clinic with some excellent people working there and some very, very fine veterinarians, and lucky to have it.
Sounds like we're pretty progressive in this area, and I think mm-hmm. one of the things is that you're very progressive as well, and I really wish you well.
Thank you.
I think we could keep talking, but we're gonna wrap it up now. But is there anything you'd like to leave with us before we sign off?
Well, one of the programs that's one of my personal favorites that we didn't get to talk about a little bit is our foster care program.
Okay.
And we might house 200 animals in our animal shelter, but right now we have 150 animals in foster homes. People who open their homes to shelter animals, a lot of them are kittens who are too young for us to adopt out. They might come in 4, 5, 6 weeks old, and they need to be at least 8 weeks old for us to adopt them out. Some animals are sick or injured and need to recover, and they go to these to people's homes, and they live there, and they're cared for, and they're all volunteers. They just do it out of the kindness of their hearts, and then they come back to the animal shelter or one of the PetSmart adoption centers, and they find new homes. But we would not be able to help nearly as many animals as we do if we did not have all these people in the community who are willing to take in an extra dog, an extra cat, a litter of kittens, and raise them and hold on to them until they're ready for adoption.
I've heard of fostering animals, and I'm glad you brought that up. And so if someone feels that they're so inclined, I'm sure you could use more people who
Absolutely.
Could do this.
Yep.
They should call you.
They should call the animal shelter and talk to our volunteer manager.
Okay.
And your first step is to go to one of the volunteer orientations, which are on the calendar on the website.
Okay.
And you start there, and then we have a foster care coordinator. She will get you set up, and you'll, depending on what sort of animal you're working with, you might learn a little bit from our veterinarians or technicians about how to care for the animal, and then you take them home, and usually 2 to 3 weeks later they'll come back and you're ready to take another one. And we have some fantastic people who really, they just save litter after litter of kittens or animal after animal and continue to find homes for them.
That's right. There are a lot of good people out there, aren't there?
I've been incredibly impressed since moving to this area, about just everywhere I turn there are people who support what we're doing.
Great. And we're going to put the phone number up so people can catch
Great.
That. And I really want to wish you well and thank you and your staff mm-hmm. for doing this. I know it's a business sort of, but mm-hmm. it's also a mission, and it's wonderful. And a subject or a place I've avoided, but now I know more about, so I feel much better about it myself.
Well, come on down.
I will. I won't be so afraid now. Thanks again, Brad, for being a guest.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
And thank you for joining me on Getting to Know You. I hope you enjoyed today's show and will join us next week. Until then, have a good one.